Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J and Dr. Gary Gates participate in a debate on the definition of marriage at UCLA. Dr. J, of course, is founding president of the Ruth Institute. Dr. Gates is a research associate at the Williams Institute at UCLA, a public policy research organization. The event was sponsored by the school's Federalist Society. Hang on for the Q&A afterward, too.
We each have 12 minutes for an opening statement, then followed by 10-minute response, and then Q&A. Is that your understanding, Gary? Okay, so we're agreed to the rules. I want to thank everybody for coming. You heard my bio. My daughter goes to Berkeley, so I hope that's okay. You see, I came in neutral colors so as not to raise any flags by having the wrong color blue or something like that and causing trouble. But I want to begin by saying that I do a lot of debating on the subject of the definition of marriage. And not too long ago, I participated in a debate at a large megachurch in San Diego. And on the other side were two gay men, including one who's Gene Robinson, the openly gay bishop of the Episcopal Church. And over the course of that debate, I learned something very important that was important to me to see. It became clear to me in the course of that debate just how deeply wounded those two men feel and how alienated they feel from society as a whole. And that so much of what we were talking about was how can we heal some of those wounds. And so as I said, there were a couple of things they said that really took my breath away because I had not really seen before what that must be like for them. And so I want to simply begin by saying that I'm sure there are people here who are same-sex attracted, male and female, and I would just like to say that I have no wish to add to any pain or anxiety or sense of alienation that you may feel. I have no wish to add to that, but I am quite convinced that I am correct on the public policy issue before us. And so I hope that we can talk about the public policy issue, and if people would like to talk about that, the other issue, which may be in some ways the deeper issue, I'd be happy to do that, but I would like to make sure that we get to cover what I think the redefinition of marriage will actually be and do and accomplish in this society. And so to convince you or to show you why I am so convinced that this would not be a good thing to do, I want to call your attention to an earlier redefinition of the institution of marriage. And that is, in 1968, California became the first state to initiate what is called no-fault divorce. What no-fault divorce did was to remove the presumption that the marital union would be permanent. And absolvable only for cause, dissolvable only for cause. No-fault divorce basically said anyone could end a marriage for any reason or no reason, you didn't have to give a reason. And what it did was remove the presumption of permanence. Now, at the time that happened, people said to themselves, this is a small thing, we've got a 6% divorce rate, it's not going to be that big of a deal. How can someone else's divorce affect your marriage? Surely you're not going to run out and get divorced just because your neighbor gets divorced. And oh, by the way, we have studies showing that children will be fine as long as their parents are happy. The divorce will not be harmful to children. Now, it has turned out that every one of those rosy predictions has turned out not to be true, that divorce is very harmful to children. We're still seeing the long-term ramifications as it works its way throughout all of society, that removing the presumption of permanence was actually quite a serious thing. And so I want you to, and it didn't happen overnight, by the way. You wouldn't have seen that in 1972. It's taken a while to see the full impact of making a change to the social structure of that magnitude. So I want to have that in the back of your minds as we go through here, that I believe removing the gender requirement for marriage will be similarly broad and expansive in its consequences, and that it will take a while to see what all of that is about. Now, to see why I believe that is true, I would like to direct your attention to what I think is the essential public purpose of marriage. That is, what is the essential public purpose of marriage? And that is to be separated from all of the private purposes or personal reasons that you might have for wanting to get married. Because obviously, there are all kind of personal reasons that people have to get married. But why do we have the institution of marriage in the first instance? And I would submit to you that the essential public purpose of marriage is to attach mothers and fathers to their children and to one another. To attach mothers and fathers to their children and to one another. Now, that is a public purpose in the sense that it it's not private, right? It's something that when we figure out that these two people are the parents of the child, that means nobody else is. Nobody else can raise their hand and say, I'm the parent of the child. That's a public function to separate, to say who's the parent and who's not the parent. And it can't be fully privatized. Secondly, it's essential in the sense that I think it's essential in a legal sense, in the sense that if you didn't need to get that job done, I doubt very seriously that anyone would have ever thought of lifelong sexual monogamy as a widespread, universal social institution. Okay? So I think it's essential, I think it's public, and I think it's different from all the whole set of private purposes and private reasons why people have for getting married. And a lot of times what you hear in these debates is people will tell you about their private purposes, whatever those might be. And so we want to start with that distinction. Now, how does marriage accomplish this purpose of attaching mothers and fathers to their children and to one another? Well, the basic legal structure, the basic way it's done, the typical way that it would be done, is that when the baby's born, there's usually you know who the mother is when a baby's born. There are some question marks around that now, a few little asterisks we have to put up there in the case of surrogate mothers. But for the most part, when a woman gives birth to a baby, she's the legal mother of the child, and nobody else is the mom. She's the mom. And so the real question is, who's the dad? Who's the daddy? Well, how do we figure out? Because daddy can be on the other side of the moon, daddy can be dead, daddy can be all over the place. So the way marriage has answered that question is with what is called the presumption of paternity. The woman's husband is presumed to be the father of any children that she gives birth to over the life of her union. The woman's husband is presumed to be the father of any children she gives birth to over the life of her of that union. Now, if you couple that legal rule with a social practice of sexual exclusivity inside of marriage, what you're doing is attaching children to their biological parents. That's essentially what you're trying to get done, is to attach children to their biological parents in a lifelong stable union, presumptively lifelong union. Now, I realize that presumption is gone, but that was the idea. And why? Because we believe in some way that children are entitled to a relationship with both of their parents, and that children therefore have a legitimate interest in the stability of their parents' union. So if mom and dad don't live together, if they're on the other side of the planet from each other, if they're not getting along, that there is somehow a right or entitlement of children that has been violated. And you can't wait and correct that after the fact of damage has been done, because the average six-year-old cannot march into court and say, get over here and do something about it. It's too late by then, and six-year-olds don't have the capacity for that. So we have an institution, a pre-existing structure that structures us going forward to create that environment in which children can have their legitimate interests protected. So it's a duty and justice to recognize the mother and the father as being the parents of that child. So now, what is the heart? So that's what I think marriage is about in the first instance. We have to know that before we know if we redefine it, what we're going to do to it. What has been happening is that if we move towards redefining marriage to remove the gender requirement, as we move towards same-sex parenting, as we move towards same-sex marriage, what we are doing in the courts on a case-by-case basis so far, but soon by legislation as well, is we're replacing the presumption of paternity, which attaches children to biological parents, with a presumption of parentage. The presumption of parentage means that if I as a woman would be married to another woman, that woman would be presumed to be the mother or the other parent of any child that I give birth to, which in 100% of the cases, she is not the biological parent of the child. And so I believe, I have, you know, don't have a lot of time to explain all of this out, but just briefly, that rule, that change in the purpose of marriage, of what marriage will do, that change to the essential public purpose of marriage, will have the effect of redefining parenthood as a byproduct of redefining marriage. And I would say to you, if you're going to redefine parenthood, we really ought to talk about it straight up and straight on, rather than just letting it happen as a byproduct of something else we think we want to do. So how does it undermine parenthood? How does it redefine parenthood? First of all, it undermines the idea that kids are entitled to a relationship with both their biological parents. It undermines the biological basis for parenthood. It says that's no longer necessary, important. And finally, it says that the state does not simply record parentage as a natural pre-existing reality, but now the state is itself creating parenthood. The state's not just recording something that's already out there, pre-political, pre-existing natural reality, but the state is taking it upon itself to create something quite new. And then finally, as a result of that, we can see that there will be an expansion in the power of the state over civil society, including parentage, but also including many of the other social institutions or civil institutions that touch upon marriage in some way. And so to demonstrate that I believe that this is true and that this, I'm not just making this up, that this is a real possibility, I would refer you to a case that has recently come up in the public sphere. It's called, it's about a little girl who is known to the public only by her initials, MC. MC was born in March of 2009. Her mother is named Melissa, and her mother was in a relationship with another woman. After this, MC was born, Melissa decided she didn't want to be in a relationship with Irene anymore. She moved out, and Irene initiated proceedings to get visitation rights and other parental rights guaranteed to her. Melissa became so enraged about that that she got one of her boyfriends to go and basically stalk Irene, and he attacked Irene and basically stabbed her so severely she ended up in the hospital. So what happened was then Irene is in the hospital because she's been stabbed by her enraged former partner. Melissa is in jail as an accessory to attempted murder. That's where she belongs, right? She arranged a murder. MC has no parent, okay? And so, but actually MC did have a parent because a previous boyfriend of Melissa's was the father of this child. Not the boyfriend who did the knifing, but another guy called Jesus. Jesus appears and says, I would like to try to exercise parental rights over my child. And what happened was the trial court said that this is kind of confusing. We're not sure. We can't give the kid, we cannot simply say we're going to give the child to Jesus, because under state law, child can only have two parents, and Irene is a presumed parent under a gender neutral reading of the Uniform Parentage Act. Because what I forgot to mention is that little MC was born in 2009. Irene and Melissa had been married in October of 2008, during the window of time that same-sex couples could be married to one another. And it was the fact of their marriage to each other under that, in that little window of time, that fact of their marriage is what triggered a gender-neutral reading of the Uniform Parentage Act, saying that Irene is a presumed parent. So MC has three parents, all coming into play by different aspects of the law. And so what happened is that the court said, we can't figure out what to do. She stayed in foster care. The only reason we know about this is because it came up on appeal. The appeals court threw it out. But the little girl stayed in foster care. As of May 2011, she was still in foster care and had been all along. What I want to point out to you is that it was same-sex marriage that triggered that gender-neutral reading of the Parentage Act. It was same-sex marriage that made it look like this little girl's got three parents, and now we have to do something about it. So what I want to say to you is that the essential public purpose of marriage, if it's true that the essential public purpose of marriage is to attach mothers and fathers to their children and to one another, then a same-sex couple is obviously different with respect to that purpose than an opposite sex couple. And if you want to do, if you are a same-sex couple and you want to share parenting with each other, you need to do some other steps. And there's nothing discriminatory about saying that and about making sure that those steps get done so that everybody knows what they're doing. So in that case, it illustrates what I think is the final point, which I'll stop on this point because I think I'm out of time. And that is that that either MC has three parents, or she only has two parents. The solution to MC's problem is to say, in California, children can have three parents. And that's what Mark Leno is trying to do. There is a state law that's gone through the Senate and that's being voted on this week in the House to say, under California law, children can have three parents. But what you're doing when you say that is you're saying that biology is no longer the baseline way that we do it, and marriage is no longer the baseline way exactly that we do it, and we're replacing the old biological system with something else to determine parentage. The alternative to that is to abandon the idea of marriage equality. because I say it's simply not possible for a same-sex couple and an opposite-sex couple to be treated the same under the law with respect to every relevant dimension of marriage. And that is why I think attempting to have same-sex marriage under any kind of equality understanding of the law, why I think that that would be a big social mistake, and I would urge you to support the traditional understanding of marriage and whatever it is that you're trying to get done by redefining marriage, that we come up with some other way to deal with those issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So, you know, the first question that I have to ask myself in terms of being here today is, well, why am I here? Why am I engaging in this discussion? And the most simple answer is that I'm actually here in protest. Because what I am not here to do is to suggest that I in any way think that this is a legitimate discussion for scholarly debate. I do not. I am in an 18-year relationship with my spouse. Make no mistake, what we are discussing here is I'm being asked by an academic institution to defend the legitimacy of my marriage. That's both offensive and insulting. So my purpose here should in no way, you should in no way take away that I believe that this is a legitimate exercise of the academy. I do not. I will say then further, to explain why I don't think this is legitimate, I'll give you a couple examples of why I think this is not, these are not arguments that have any kind of scholarly merit. And the first is that there's no empirical support for this notion that allowing same-sex couples to marry will have these kind of social impacts. And I'll talk about that a lot further later. But as my first example of that evidence, I'll cite David Blankenhorn. And for those of you who don't know David Blankenhorn, he was the, I believe, only expert witness in the Prop 8 trial for the yes on AIDS side, so the side that was defending marriage being restricted to only different sex couples. And he said, if fighting gay marriage was going to help marriage overall, I think we'd have seen some sign of it by now. The point being, he's seen no empirical evidence that this has any particular effect on marriage. Secondly, I think another issue that puts into question the legitimacy of these kind of arguments is the degree to which, in general, the support for confining marriage to only different sex couples is undergirded by a very, very strong public anti-gay animus. And again, I cite David Blankenhorn. He said, to my deep regret, much of the opposition to gay marriage seems to stem, at least in part, from an underlying anti-gay animus. Finally, the last point I'll make in terms of this legitimacy argument is that, as you've heard in Dr. Morse's discussion now, the side that supports restricting marriage only to different sex couples wants to talk about the institution of marriage. Unfortunately, that's not the terms of this debate, and I'm not going to allow that to be the terms of this debate. This debate is about the real lives of real people. It's not about the institution of marriage. And again, I quote David Blankenhorn, in the mind of today's public, gay marriage is almost entirely about accepting lesbians and gay men as equal citizens. That is what the public thinks that this debate is about. And to that end, I'll show this brief video.
Come on, that's what I'd like to know.
Good job, Biden.
At the soccer field, they are two moms cheering for the same child. But in church, Letitia Bynes and her partner, Misty Gray of Jacksonville, Florida, are part of a new face on the old Bible Belt. Same-sex couples raising children turning to pro-gay churches for support and acceptance.
Okay, we're gay, we're lesbian, but our God still loves us. No matter what.
A surprising UCLA study of the 2010 census reveals same-sex couples in the South are more likely to be raising children than similar couples even on the West Coast. San Antonio was number one, number two, Jacksonville. It took one phone call to find out why.
Why is this happening in the South of all places? Gay and lesbian people tend to come out later in life in those areas, which means they're actually more likely to have children early from a prior relationship earlier in their lives.
Demographer Gary Gates cites another big reason, Southern pro-gay churches reaching out to minorities and creating safety nets for the entire family.
Of course, not all churches are happy to hear about this trend. This, in fact, is one of them here in the Jacksonville area. The leader of this church is calling on pastors all over the city to pray.
I believe that they should be preaching a positive message that Jesus is right.
And that these couples, they should not have gay relationships?
I believe that the couples in the church should have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ that would bring a conviction that Jesus taught and the scriptures teach that marriage is between a man and a woman. Simple.
But not so simple for people like Letitia Bonds, raising her three biological children with her partner, Misty Gray.
Hetero, homo, it doesn't matter.
Right.
Either way.
Yeah, definitely.
It's a great support system. Today.
And their pastor believes happy parents start with happy children.
The focus is the children.
Yes, absolutely. The children being able to serve God with their families and not being judged.
It wasn't too long ago that gay and lesbian couples might have thought it was too risky to bring their children to church with them.
This Jacksonville church was firebombed three times back in the 1980s. Now it is a place for family worship and youth groups, signs of the times, and a changing Bible Belt. David Mattingly, CNN, Jacksonville, Florida.
So that to me is what this debate is actually about. And I'm going to switch gears now and talk a little bit about this argument of what the public purpose of marriage is. I think the idea that you can somehow create a public purpose of marriage that's divorced from why people get married and why they see the institution of marriage as being important just seems incredibly odd to me. So why do people get married? Well, it turns out, according to Pew Research, that the main reason people get married is love, commitment, and companionship. And while certainly having children within the context of marriage is important, it's kind of fourth on that list. So the public purpose of marriage, if you ask the public, is in fact love and commitment and dignity and respect for that relationship. That's the public purpose for marriage. But I'm an empiricist, and I'm trained as an economist. And so I think that we can actually test empirically whether, in fact, if this essential public purpose of marriage is to encourage a society where children are raised in stable families with their biological mothers and fathers, I think we can empirically test, well, is that working? And because the implication of that statement is that if you support the idea that marriage can be available to same-sex couples, then that support should be associated with a reduction in the likelihood that children are raised with their different sex married biological parents. That should be associated with an increase in the likelihood that children are raised in single parents and a decrease in the stability of marriages. So the empirical test I'm going to run is to consider the relationship between, at a state level, the support for marriage being available to same-sex couples and the percent of children living with their different sex married parents, the percent living with a single parent, and the divorces out of, how many divorces out of 100 married people occurred in the last year. It turns out that in places that where there's a majority support for different sex, allowing only different sex couples to marry, that proportionally fewer children are being raised by their different sex married parents, that proportionally more children are being raised by single mothers and fathers, and the divorce rate is actually higher. But That could be explained in part by the fact that the states that allow same-sex couples to marry are demographically different from those other states. So, I'm an economist, I run regressions. So, I'm gonna run a regression in which I ask, how does support for same-sex couples getting married, how is that related to these three different outcomes, taking into account the age, the race, racial ethnic distribution in the population, and the median household income? So if we take those things to account, do we still find that this has some impact on these outcomes? And the results are, yes, they do. It turns out that in states, the stronger the support for marriage for same-sex couples, the more likely children are to be raised with their different sex married parents, the less likely they are to be living with a single parent, and the higher, and that as support for same-sex couples goes up, divorce goes down. So, but you know, those are coefficients. What do they mean kind of in a real sense? Well, if you believe this regression, it says that if we create a world where everybody believes that marriage should be exclusively reserved to different sex couples, 56% of children would live with their different sex married parents. But if we create a world where everybody believes that marriage should be open to same-sex couples, we would increase that to 70%. If we did that, we would also cut the rate of children raised by single parents in half. And we would also cut the divorce rate in half. So my argument is that whatever these kind of issues around how this support for same-sex couples getting married might impact the public understanding of marriage, the evidence just doesn't hold up. In fact, if anything, the evidence suggests that support for same-sex couples getting married is good for kids. And it's good for marriages. It makes them more stable and it reduces divorce. And my argument for why that is that places that are supportive of same-sex couples getting married actually have less rigid social structures and norms about relationships and family, and allows people to be in relationships and to form families that work the best for them and that ultimately are more stable. And it doesn't force them into situations that are ultimately not good for them, resulting in divorce. So finally, I will close with saying that we want the folks who support different sex, limiting marriage to different sex couples, want this argument to all be about the institution of marriage. It just isn't. This is an argument about real people. And real people say that the public purpose of marriage is love and commitment and companionship. That's why people get married. And the terms of the debate should not be about whether this is going to affect the institution of marriage. The terms of this debate are about the real effect this has on people and their children. And that effect, and in general, I would argue that equality and dignity for all couples and their families ultimately benefits not just lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people, it benefits everybody. And I would argue that my empirical evidence suggests that that is the case. Thank you.
Okay, let me take a few minutes to respond. I get 10 minutes to respond to what we just saw and heard. Okay, first of all, I think that Dr. Gates and I are using the term public purpose of marriage in quite different ways, and purpose of marriage in quite different ways. When I say the public purpose of marriage, what I'm talking about is why is it that the state or the government or the public has any particular interest at all in people's private relationships. In other words, I'm sure Gary has a wonderful relationship with his partner. I'm totally prepared to believe that that's the case. The question is, why does the public care one way or another? Why does the public care enough to establish a set of laws, norms, institutional structures. You can't get away from the fact that we've got an institutional component to this discussion. Why does the public care enough to give tax breaks or inheritance rules or anything like that to have anything at all depend on marital status? I would say to you that the answer to that question is what I'm talking about when I talk about the public purpose of marriage. So in other words, the fact that that I want to get married because I think I'm going to, I want to have love and commitment, and that's really important to me, that's not enough reason for the government to take any interest whatsoever in whether I successfully achieve that purpose. It's not the state's business. It's not Gary's purpose. It's not anybody's purpose. It's not a public purpose. It's a wonderful private purpose. But why do you have institutional structures to support that particular kind of friendship or relationship or love life or whatever you want to call it? Why do we have that? And I would submit to you that that Gary really didn't address the key point which I made, which is why do we have any kind of set aside for one kind of relationship rather than any other kind of relationship? We don't have special set asides for two women who live together all their life and take care of their elderly mother, even though their relationship deserves respect and so on. Those two women, if they were lesbians and lived in one of these states that has same-sex unions, they could inherit property from one another tax-free. But if they're sisters, they can't, you know. And so the question is, why does the state actually take any interest in any kind of relationships at all? And I would submit to you that he has not really addressed that question, which is the reason the state or the public has any interest in the issue at all is that we believe correctly that children have an interest in the stability of their parents' union. And that is why we set aside an institutional structure that in a proactive institutional way gives them some stability in the relationship. Now, let's talk about the empirical results that he gave. I think, if I'm not mistaken, that what we're tracking here is Iowa plus the Northeast. Okay, these are the states that we must be talking about. And a couple of those states only enacted same-sex unions fairly recently, so I'm not sure how the causality is actually working here because I wasn't clear on the date, and maybe you can clarify that for us later. But the main thing that I want to say about these numbers is the state-level data, if you're looking at Iowa plus the Northeast, basically, the idea that you could extrapolate that and say that these are the results that if we had same-sex unions everywhere, that would apply to every other state in the union, I think that is really not credible, even with the controls that you have in there. Okay, I mean, I realize those are the most basic controls, but the other important controls we didn't talk about are significantly the age at first marriage. The age at first marriage in the Northeast is significantly higher than elsewhere, which means that they're going to have more stability in the union, okay? And so, therefore, it's simply not valid, I think, to extrapolate the results that we have here and say, well, if all we have to do to have marriage more stable, generally speaking, is to expand the support for same-sex unions. The fact is the instability of marriage and the problems with heterosexual marriage vastly predate the problems that are arising because of same-sex unions. I'll be the first to admit that. I spent all my time trying to deal with divorce, you know, and trying to deal with cohabitation and all of these other questions. So you're not going to correct those problems by having same-sex marriage. And I think this is really simply not a valid extrapolation from the data that is on hand. And then finally, I think it's important to say that the structure, the causal mechanism that I discussed is really not being addressed here. And that is that the law does something particular about identifying the parents of children. And that will have to change, okay? And in my opinion, it is no expression of indignity or disapproval or anything else to point out that the different kinds of couples have to solve that problem in a different way. So the problem with little MC and her situation, the problem that took place due to a civil union in Vermont with the Miller-Jenkins case, is a very similar kind of situation. The birth mother in those cases, I just want you to point out the institutional consequence of the same-sex union. The birth mother in those cases, unbeknownst to her, I'm quite certain that these women did not realize what they were doing, what they were agreeing to when they married another woman. What they were agreeing to is that they were going to share parenting of any children they had with another woman whom they may love, Another woman who maybe they had this all planned out. Maybe like in the case of Melissa and Irene, they didn't have it all planned out. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. The law will apply to everyone, no matter how carefully or incautiously they enter into these unions. The fact is, what she's agreeing to is that she is going to share parenting of her child with another woman. Most mothers find that very difficult to do. It is not an automatic thing to do. It is not an easy thing to do. In fact, most mothers find it difficult to even share the care of their child with the child's father. That's just kind of how we are, how women are when we give birth to a child. And the law in most instances correctly recognizes that the maternal bond is something special, by which I mean that if a woman made an agreement, if one of you made an agreement that you would, and you were pregnant and you agreed you were going to give your child up to somebody else to adopt, you could agree to that, you could exchange money. In most states, you're not really allowed to exchange money, but you could make an agreement, and once the baby was born, you could change your mind. In virtually every state, you cannot have a forward adoption contract that is enforced by the government. Why? Because the state recognizes the special nature of that maternal bond, that you don't really know how it's going to feel until that baby's born. It is only a woman in a same-sex union, it is only a mother in a same-sex union who is required by law, in effect, to put her child up for adoption and then surrender the care of her child and then zip in instantly and readopt that child with her same-sex partner. Why do I say that that's in effect what she's being asked to do? Because under this way of interpreting the law, the biological mother has no particular privilege over the non-biological mother in the couple. That's where these laws go. That's where they have to go. There's an actual statute in Delaware that says that. That's kind of where Mark Leno's statute is going to go. And I simply want to say to you that this is something very serious that we're asking of people. That mother, in a relationship with another woman, she is not being treated equally to other mothers. And so I guess the point that I want to really leave you with is to simply think about this notion of marriage equality. Equality is not a standalone concept. It is not a self-interpreting concept. Equality requires a context. That is, we have to ask ourselves, who is equal to whom, under what circumstances, and for what purposes? And until we answer those questions, it doesn't make sense to just say what we want is equality. So I think that in point of fact, it isn't really possible to make male couples, female couples, and opposite sex couples equal in every single aspect that touches marriage. And I think that to say that what we're really talking about is individual persons and individual lives, and we're not talking about the institution of marriage, I'm sorry, I cannot accept that. The fact is, if we restructure the institutions, we are going to affect individual people's lives. We're going to make it difficult for people to manage their lives and to have the framework that they need to do the job that needs to get done of parenting. And so that is why I continue to believe, with all due respect to my colleague here, that the institution, that the discussion must be about the institution of marriage. In addition to whatever we want to say about individuals, we must take responsibility for what it is we're doing to the institutional structure of marriage. And if we only focus on individuals and how they feel and what they want, we will miss that whole aspect of what is at stake in the marriage debate. Thank you.
So a couple comments to that. First, quite frankly, I don't have a partner. I have a husband. He's not my partner. He's my husband. But to address specifically this issue of how we frame this idea of public interest or state interest in regulating parenting and regulating those issues, look, the bottom line to that is that there are lots of ways. If we believe that there's a specific governmental interest in making sure that kids have access to their biological parents. Let's say for a moment we just say that that's some legitimate government purpose. There are plenty of ways for the government to do that without restricting marriage to only different sex couples. You don't have to funnel that all through marriage. That's just preposterous. Marriage has a meaning in our society that goes far beyond children. Marriage is the way that our society understands that a couple has made a commitment to each other that is arguably permanent, but certainly it offers a dignity and a social acceptance and respect for that relationship. That is what marriage does. And when the government restricts marriage to only different sex couples, it is a government imprimatur on the notion that same-sex relationships do not have that dignity or that respect. That is what happens when the government puts that kind of sanction on same-sex couples. If the government and the public believes that they need to regulate how, you know, children have access to their parents, fine, regulate it. But it doesn't have to, it's ridiculous to assume that it has to all be funneled through this institution of marriage, which has many, many more public meanings than the relationship of children to their parents. So, you know, that's my simple kind of response to that piece of the argument. And secondly, I think I'll go a little further and say, I will challenge that you can't separate this debate from this issue of anti-gay animus. And the degree to which that marriage for different sex couples only gets supported in the government, or supported by voters and courts, if you could somehow take out animus, that debate would just never win. That's what's undergirding the whole support for this. If you look at the folks out there who are some of the most vocal opponents of same-sex couples getting married, their language is vicious and horrible. And they hate LGBT people. And they don't want them to get this status where their relationships are given the same dignity and respect as different sex couples. So I think we can't have this debate about the institution of marriage without understanding that dynamic of the debate. And because I just think it's crucial. And I would argue, you know, again, with all due respect, it came out in the fact that my husband was referred to as a partner. He's not. And to suggest that he is animus towards gay people. That's what that is. Because it's denying the dignity of that relationship. And it's saying that it's somehow separate or different. Look, do I think that men and women behave differently than how two men behave or two women behave? Yes. But it doesn't change the fact that these are loving, committing relationships that often include children. If it looks like a duck, walks like a duck, quacks like a duck, it's a duck. And I'll stop there.
All right, so we've got about 15 minutes for questions. So if you got a question, raise your hand. We'll start right there.
My name's Tim Broskos. I'm a professor in the poli-sci and economics department. I don't know if you can do it. Can you flash up that equation again?
Uh-oh.
Sure.
Uh-oh. I have to tell you, I've done a lot of these debates. We've never had numbers up here before, Gary. This is fabulous. This is fabulous because usually, Gary, in law school, they're all math phobic.
Yeah, I know.
They're all math phobic.
Lawyer,
animus against math, you know, is very serious in law school. So go for it, Tim.
So why the dependent variable? This is unfair. Can I ask, you've had graduate courses.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
I have a PhD.
In economics.
Well, in public policy, but I'm trained as an economist.
You've had a PhD course in economics?
Sure.
Okay. So, we use the same language. So why is the dependent variable, right, and the interesting independent variables that mar SS?
Right.
And if I understand right, you're trying to say something that there's a causal effect of
yep.
mar SS, and that's captured in beta 2.
Yep.
But I think we can both agree that there's a potential endogeneity problem in this, right?
Sure.
And that's why you need control variables.
Right.
Right.
Well, what's the endogeneity? How could children being raised by different sex, you're essentially arguing that there's that having more children in different sex married couples can create increased support for same-sex couples getting married?
No, you said it best in your talk, that there are demographic variables that could be correlated. The endogeneity, technically it means that epsilon is correlated with more.
With Maris, but it also means that Y causes Maris S and Maris S causes Y. That's what endogeneity means, ultimately.
But my point is, to remove that endogeneity problem, you have to measure all the demographic variables, everything in epsilon, or I hope you'd agree.
This explains 70% of the variance.
You have to do an experiment,
right?
Either a natural experiment, and you need an instrument. And I hope we agree that I haven't heard that. I haven't heard an experiment or a natural experiment.
Do you think there are omitted variables, Tim?
Sure.
What would you say are the most important? What do you think are the most important ones? I'm just.
One, you said that the age at which you get married.
Yeah.
You know that everything that you can imagine in that epsilon.
Here's my short response to all that, which is just that. Look. Do I think this is the definitive statement on all this? Absolutely not. However, I use it primarily as an illustration of the fact, in some respects, an illustration of the absurdity of this discussion. Because I just don't see how you can causally suggest that allowing same-sex couples, who are, by the way, only 1 in 100 couples in the United States, how allowing them to marry is somehow going to have this unbelievable impact on this institution of marriage. It numerically doesn't work. And in fact, the kind of thought exercise that I posit here is, if anything, it appears to work in the opposite direction. The notions of, to the degree that marital support is capturing people's sense of equality and dignity, that's good for kids, it's good for families, it's good for people. And it has a broad impact on society that will overcome many of the drawbacks that Dr. Morse argues for.
Go a little right there.
All right, so our society and the government under the institution of marriage, we disapprove of many different types of relationships. So in only supporting male-female adult marriages, that we also don't allow, infertile sibling couples or father-son couples or mother-daughter couples. Would you say that we're not allowing gay marriage is in a way to kind of put gay relationships below male-female marriages. Do you think the government not allowing, say, infertile sibling couples or father-son couples is to taking those relationships and putting those below male-female adult marriage? And if so, do you think they're justified in doing that or not justified in doing that? Do you think those relationships should be put below as less dignified than a male-female adult relationship?
You're asking him. Okay.
So, look, my view on that is that if an infertile sibling couple, if they're raising their parents, if they're elderly parents, they're taking care of their elderly parents, do I think that should they, by law, somehow be treated? No, well, let me finish. should they have the rights that a married couple would, because they're a couple living together and they're doing things that we somehow privilege marriage for? Do I think that they should have that? Yes. And I think you can do that without letting them get married. Do I think we should allow them to get married? No. But again, that slippery slope, you're essentially arguing a slippery slope.
No, I'm just saying, do you think their marriage would be, say, lesser than yours?
I don't think they're married, for one thing. And I don't think that has anything to do with we right now, as a governmental, our government does define marriage in a particular way. And what I'm arguing is that the distinction of same-sex couples and different-sex couples is arbitrary. The distinction of siblings and unrelated people probably isn't as arbitrary. And not the least of which is that you can say infertile, but, you know, they could potentially...
Take father's son, then. You like father's son.
The bottom line for me is... That question has nothing to do with the debate about whether same-sex couples or different-sex couples who are unrelated and same-sex couples who meet all the requirements of what we consider marriage now, should they be denied simply based on their gender? No, I don't think they should be. And fathers and sons can't get married now, so I don't understand why that's an interesting point.
Well, I'm just wondering if you think that subjugating those relationships is bigoted towards loving couples of that type. And so I'm wondering, like, just by the fact that we are subjugating a relationship doesn't necessarily mean it's the wrong thing.
You have to define why you're subjugating the same-sex relationships relative to different-sex relationships.
Right, so I would say that there's more similarity. Brother-sister marriage, loving, committed sexual relationship is more... I mean, you could argue, like, it could be just as in line as a two adults who are...
Well, I wouldn't make that argument.
Let's move on. Go right there.
I'm just kind of going off of his point. Maybe father-son is a little bit too kind of difficult for us to comprehend, but what about polyamorous couples? There's about like 400,000 polyamorous couples in the United States today, and many supporters of same-sex marriage are like drawing the line, no, we can't allow polyamorous couples to get married. What would you say to that? That's a rather arbitrary distinction, right?
What I say is, right now, the government defines marriage as between two people. And they make an arbitrary distinction that those two people have to be different sex. If we want to have a debate about polyamorous marriages and polygamy, I'm fine with having that debate. But the notion that allowing same-sex couples to marry in some ways leads us down this slippery slope to polyandry and polygamy, first, I think that's a fallacious argument. And second, I would just add that, you know, almost the majority of the population in the world right now lives in a place where, in fact, polygamy is legal. And the current, you know, Republican candidate for president is only two generations removed from a polygamous family. So, I mean, polygamy is not some, like, weird construct out there. We can have that debate in this country, but it has nothing to do with this debate.
I'd like to, if I may, may I chime in on this? I think that where people are having a problem is with your assertion that the male-female prerequisite is arbitrary. Okay, and so it depends on what you're trying to get done by recognizing these kinds of,
right,
some kinds of relationships as worthy somehow of government attention, not worthy of anything else necessarily, but at least worthy of government attention. That male-female prerequisite is required. So I think what is bothering people is that if you say the male-female prerequisite is arbitrary, we say it isn't arbitrary because what marriage is doing is uniting the whole of the sexual spectrum, which is one man, one woman, and creating a complementary whole by doing that. And if you remove that understanding of what marriage marriage is and what it does. If you take that away, then what is the stopping principle? What is the principle by which you rule out unions of more than two persons? Okay, and so that's what these questions are really about, finally.
That's based on the idea that the whole of the sexual spectrum is captured by men and women. That's just false. That's just false.
Well,
there are people who live their entire sexual lives in sexual relationships with someone in the same sex.
No, I realize that, but you're still a man.
Okay.
Good. Okay. I'm glad we agreed. But I want to say something about what you said about your husband, okay, Gary, because you took offense at my referring to him as partner. I want you to understand that in the law, in the state of Washington, when they redefined marriage earlier this spring, right in the enabling legislation, right as part of the bill, it said, what we're going to do is every place it says marriage is the union of a man and woman, we're going to take that out and we're going to put in union of any two persons. And then it said, every place in the law where it says husband or wife, we're going to take that out and we're going to say partner. So when I say partner, there's some legal reason, and that's kind of what's being done to us. The gendered language is being taken out. Mother and father has to go away too, right? And have, you know, more generic birth certificates and things like that. So it's not something I did out of meanness. It's just something I believe this is part of what's entailed in the redefinition of marriage.
Let's go right there.
So when you were talking about the raising of children and the children's attachment to their biological parents being the reason for the institution of marriage, you didn't really address the fact that reproductive technology in recent years has created a lot of families where there are children of heterosexual parents who are not biologically related to one or both of their parents, in addition to the fact that a lot of family case law over the last at least 50 years has dealt with relationships where there's been a presumption of parenthood of a father who's married to the mother, but when there's another biological parent involved because the mother has had an affair, there's still a presumption that a non-biological father is the father of a
right,
child.
Right.
And I'm interested to know where that fits in your framework.
Okay, we've got two issues here. The second one, the law has always, to the best of my knowledge, done just what you said, which is that the husband is presumed to be the parent, the father of the child, even if she had an affair. And that's why the reason that has been done, to the best of my understanding, is to preserve the stability of the marital relationship, which is considered to be an overarching good at the institutional level, even though in particular cases it doesn't track perfectly with biology. So that's been a part of the law for a long time to recognize that. To the second issue, having to do with artificial reproductive technologies, I think, you know, I'm perfectly well aware that people are doing all kinds of things with artificial reproductive technology. In point of fact, to the best of my knowledge, the rule is anybody with money gets to do anything they want in this area. And I think that it has created enormous injustices, enormous problems, and my disdain for that technology is not limited to the sexual orientation of who's using it. I mean, that's the least of the problems, in my opinion, with that. I think there's something very inhuman that we are doing to ourselves in our rush to embrace these artificial technologies. So, you know, that's probably not a satisfactory answer for many of you, but that's my honest to goodness opinion about it. I should just say one thing. I'd like to say just one thing. My husband and I spent 4.5 years dealing with infertility. And one of the things that I had to come to terms with during that 4.5 years was the fact that I was not entitled to a child just because I wanted one. You know, and so that was a very hard pill to swallow. It was terrible. But it was, I think, the most significant thing that I learned from the whole experience. And so when our son came to us from Romania, we could see him for what he was, a gift from God, and not the product of our effort, not the product of our doing somehow. And likewise, when our daughter was born to us 6 months later, completely naturally, we didn't do anything fancy, you know. I mean, she was not supposed to be possible. She was a gift from God and not the product of our will and our desire and our entitlement somehow. And so I think I just want to put that on the table so that you guys all know that my position about that subject has absolutely nothing to do with sexual orientation. That's not the issue as far as I'm concerned, whatever.
One little addendum I'll make to that too is that Dr. Morse talked about these kind of this particular case about where, in her view, the child was not well served by this notion of the two women being parents. And, you know, I'm not going to debate that one way or another. What I will say is you can come up with plenty of other cases where children were entirely not well served by the court recognizing the different sex marriage of a couple and refusing to recognize the parental bonds that had occurred with same-sex couples. And they did not serve those children well by privileging the different sex marriage in a way that as I said, harmed the kids. So, you know, one single court case does not, to me, make a very strong argument that this is, you know, that somehow if we restrict marriage to different sex couples, that'll solve all these problems with these child custody cases. It won't at all.
How long do we have?
We've got time for one last really quick question. So I'll go on this side. We'll go right there.
Me?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is for Dr. Morris. One of your assumptions for, I guess, your, I would say, argument that the government is attempting to attach children to parents and parents to each other through marriage is that the government, when it takes a certain action, has one particular purpose. And I don't know many people who believe in their government or their government officials enough to say that there's always one purpose to an action. So my view is that the government issues a marriage license, and then the people in the marriage license have a contract. The government issues licenses for many reasons, and then contracts are enforced for many more reasons. So I guess, why is your view so rigid that there's only one main reason for the government to have marriage?
Are you a Federalist Society guy?
No.
Oh, dang, you sound like a libertarian. I thought you were like a Ron Paul guy or something. Not to offend, hurt your feelings or anything, but it's not so much that I'd say there's one and only one purpose. That isn't really what I mean to say. What I mean to say is that we normally don't think the government has any business approving or disapproving, monitoring, registering, recording our private relationships with one another. We normally don't think they have anything to do with that. Okay, and so to say that the government is going to do such a thing about one kind of relationship, namely marriage, you got to have a reason. I think you got to have a reason to do that. Okay, so that's that. I think, and the only public reason I can see is the vulnerability of the helpless child who has a legitimate interest that the child cannot enforce themselves. So that's the answer to that part. Sorry?
Sort of the question.
Sorry?
I would argue there's lots of public reasons that the government wants to allow couples to regulate the economics of their households. And
really?
And, yeah. Right.
Really?
I mean, that's the,
why?
Inheritance,
why should
rights.
Inheritance rights.
Structure, any of those things. Like, there's lots of public reasons. And that, in fact, is the stated public reason that the government gives.
And inheritance rights?
Sure. That's one of the reasons why the government...
Government makes a distinction between married couples and non-married couples with respect to inheritance. They need not do so, however. You could imagine a regime of marriage that where inheritance was completely out of the picture.
Imagine a regime in which you do what you're talking about with children.
No, you can't.
In the absence of marriage.
No,
you
really can't. You really
can't.
Yeah, okay, when I imagine it, it's a nightmare. It's a nightmare. And that's because I dealt with foster care where you had kids, where you had parental rights parceled out amongst different people. That's part of what foster care does. But I want to answer your contract question first. And I see a really eager person back there. Really eager person back there. Contracts are not adequate to address the problem of parenthood. Contracts are of short duration and limited purpose, and parenthood is forever and total. And that's the difference. You can't do it while with contract. Sorry?
A marriage contract would be for the length of the contract.
A five-year renewable term contract for marriage, is that what you're saying?
No, it's a contract between the two people, and they can get out of that contract by a divorce if they want to. And it could go on there. Many people, perhaps people in here, who have parents who have stayed together for the entirety of their lives. So the contract, it's not the length of the contract, it's the fact that the government issues a license, then there's a contract, and the government has some sort of motive in protecting the rights of individuals in a contract. But it doesn't mean it only has one motive in issuing marriage licenses.
I hate to stop it, but we got to get out of here within 5 minutes for another class. So
I would like to say one thing to you, Gary.
Yes.
A man who thinks that millions of people hate him is a man who needs love.
Thank you.
And I would like to just make myself available to you.
Thank you.
You've just been listening to Dr. J and Dr. Gary Gates debating the definition of marriage and fielding questions afterward. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.